I want to get into our message this morning, but let's thank the Lord once again for this opportunity we have to be together. Heavenly Father, we love you. We know that we can bring all things to you. We praise you for who you are. We know you're interested in our lives. We know that you've given us so much through your Son. We know that your grace is sufficient for us. We thank you for all the heavenly blessings and spiritual places that are ours, spiritual blessings and heavenly places that are ours right now, this very moment. We just thank you for that. I thank you that you not only saved us through the finished work of your Son, but we were sealed by the Holy Spirit of promise unto the day of redemption. Oh, glory be to God. We just thank you for your message. We thank you for what you have for us in your word. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Well, as you know, the title we chose for our conference, I think one of our best, is Our Last Days, The Mystery of Iniquity. Now, we've talked about a lot of things up to this point. We've talked about the character of man in the last days, as Paul presents those characteristics in his second letter to Timothy. We've talked about how men will be lovers of themselves as this age winds to a close. We've talked about how men will not only be doing that, but how Satan's ministers will be using men to do his bidding, and how they'll be operating within a religious structure that denies the gospel of the grace of God. We looked at the characteristics of the religious structure as this age nears its culmination. We looked at how Satan's ministers will be deceiving men through the avenue of the superstition as well as the avenue of supernatural. Last evening we looked at superstition. This morning we talked about how to detect a satanically designed counterfeit miracle. I want to take this final message then to show you the mystery of iniquity and how it's related to Satan's activity, directly related to Satan's activity in the last days of the age of grace. I don't want to lose you through this. I would say this message will be more... Some people have jokingly said, wow, you lapsed out of teaching and went to preaching there for a while. I don't want to lose you in this because this is going to be more teaching perhaps, but I want you to pay especially close attention this morning. Try to stay with me through some of these things because I'm going to take you through several verses. But we're going to have to go back this morning to see what Satan was predicted to do after this age comes to a close in order to understand what he's doing in this age. So I'm going to take you to what Satan's going to do down the road so that you might see what he's doing today, and Paul's going to tie the two together. Paul uses an expression in 1 Thessalonians, the day of the Lord, the time when God will forcibly exercise his rule and authority here on planet Earth. We know that it covers the entire tribulation period, as well as the thousand-year millennial reign. The seven-year tribulation is considered to be a wrath period for Israel. The entire seven-year period is connected to the wrath of Leviticus 26 that Israel will face in her history. So, if you've got any notion, you've come in here with any notion that, well, we're going to be here for 3.5 years of that tribulation, then taken out, or taken out just prior to God's wrath being rained down, if you do a study on this, you'll find that the entire seven-year period is associated with the wrath, the judgment, sitting in Leviticus 26. So Israel has 7 years in front of her when God restores that program of God's judgment. Remember, what does 1 John 9 tell them? If we confess our sins, 1 John 1:9 to Israel, take it back and link it in to Leviticus 26:40. If my people shall humble themselves and confess of their iniquity and their fathers before them, and accept then the punishment of the punishment that's coming, they have to accept the 7 years remaining after they make that confession, because they have 7 years on their plate, no matter what they confess, before that kingdom will be set up. There's a wonderful memory verse in connection with the tribulation. Paul tells us about it in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 9. For God hath not appointed us to wrath, and I take that to mean any of the wrath associated with Israel's last judgment, which would be in the entire 7 years, but to obtain salvation, deliverance from that wrath by our Lord Jesus Christ. Good news from Paul here. We will be delivered from the time of Israel's tribulation by way of the rapture of the body of Christ. Of course, we needn't come up with the idea that because we have deliverance from Israel's time of trouble, Jacob's tribe of time of trouble there, Israel's tribulation period, we needn't come up with the idea that since we have deliverance from that, we believers of the age of grace have an automatic pass when it comes to tribulation. We certainly will not. Paul said, yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer what? Persecution, 2 Timothy 3:12. He went on in verse 13 to say, evil men and seducers shall be doing what? Waxing worse and worse. We've been looking at that, haven't we, over this weekend. I think we've hopefully covered it in enough detail to have it fresh in your mind. So we've not been given a pass where tribulation is concerned. It can certainly get much worse than it is today for believers. It's just an age of grace tribulation and time of Jacob's tribulation are two entirely different things. Persecution and suffering, troubling circumstances in a wide variety of ways will very likely increase, or at least I would expect them to, as this age of grace winds onward toward its culmination, toward the time of the rapture. But as I said, our tribulation and the seven-year tribulation are two entirely different things. I'm going to have to take you into Israel's time of tribulation and what will happen there for you to see what doth already work in ours. Now, we've been given a pass when it comes to Israel's remaining time of wrath, called the tribulation. When you see the definite article, for instance, in passages such as Matthew chapter 24, verse 29, let's read it. Immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened, the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of the heavens shall be shaken. You'll notice the little word the, three-letter word the, in front of the word tribulation. The definite article the there tells us, it gives the noun tribulation specificity, we could say. We know that the writer has a certain time of tribulation in mind, because he's included the definite article, the particular tribulation. You'd have to go to the context to see what tribulation is being spoken of, or any other thing where you see the definite article in front of it. Of course, we also know from the address, being the book of Matthew, that the tribulation mentioned here is Israel-specific. When we read immediately after the tribulation of those days, we know that it's talking about the tail end, we could say, of Jacob's seven-year time of trouble. And what a time that will be, if you read through those passages. Understand the entire period, seven-year period, is called the tribulation. But the final 3.5 years of that tribulation, which we'll be focusing in on this morning, God calls great tribulation. Notice Matthew 24:21. For then shall be great tribulation, such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time. No, nor shall ever shall be. What a time that will be for those folks living in that horrific time. The great tribulation. The tribulation is wrath, but the great tribulation. Now for this morning's message and more complete understanding of the mystery of iniquity, I want to take you to Paul's second letter to Thessalonians, chapter 2, where Paul's going to provide some additional details for us. Let's begin with verse 1, and we'll work our way on down to that section where Paul talks about something withholding and someone letting in the Old English, commonly translated restraining. Have you heard the notion? Restraining. The idea of something holding back the appearance of the Antichrist. Let's look at that. Verse 1 in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and by our gathering together unto Him, that ye be not soon shaken in mind, or be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter as from us, as that the day of Christ is at hand. By the use of the language here, Paul's actually pleading with these saints to not be shaken in mind. In other words, I don't want you folks to be rattled, and I know you are. I think of him by way of this letter sort of grabbing these folks by the collar and just shaking them a bit while he cries, calm down, settle down here, listen to me, you do not have to be troubled, relax. Don't let the day of the Lord rattle you. I'm pleading with you by or on the basis of the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ for you and by our gathering together with Him where? Into the air. Paul's reminding them here that he had told them in his first letter some things about the rapture. He's reassuring them that they will be caught up together with the saints of this age who had already experienced physical death into the air to be with the Lord, and that their catching away to be with the Lord will take place prior to the rapture. He's comforting them here. How do we know? Can we be absolutely certain that's what Paul is up to here? Certainly we can. Look at verse 3. Let no man deceive you by any means. In our current day, we could say whether it be the mid-rapture folks, whether it be the Marvin Rosenthal followers who talk about a pre-wrath rapture, or anyone else for that matter, including the no-rapture folks. For that day, what day again? The day of the Lord shall not come, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. Of all the evidences Paul gives that the rapture of the saints of this present age will precede the tribulation, this is the most striking when we come to understand it. I say that because of something very interesting sitting here in the translation. You see, there are a couple words here that are actually not in the original. Can anyone guess which words I'm talking about? I'm sorry? Are they italicized? Okay, I'm not looking at that. For that day, let me give you the words. Tell me if you're right. For that day, what day again? The day of the Lord shall not come except there come. Is a falling away in italics? Guess what? A falling away is not in the original. Surprise you? Except there come a falling away first. If you've guessed the words falling away, then you're correct. You see, falling away is not in the Textus Receptus. Let me show you what I'm talking about here. Oftentimes, the translators would use what is called a transliteration. You know what I'm talking about here? For instance, they don't have an English word that's comparable, so they just bring the Greek word over, and that's called a transliteration. From the Greek word, for instance, dunamis, we get our word dynamite. You see how they just brought it over because they didn't have a word in the English to describe what the Greeks were talking about, so they brought over dunamis, dynamite. They just brought it over. It's talking about power in relation to potential. So when looking for a word that would express great power, the word dynamite was transliterated or carried over from the Greek dunamis. But understand, dunamis and dynamite are not one and the same thing. Real connection, but not necessarily one and the same thing. Dynamite is not the exact equivalent of dunamis, but it's the idea of the power that's present in dunamis. Are you with me so far? Well, there's another Greek word for which we have an English transliteration, and it's the Greek word apostasia. Apostasia, that's in the original. Apostasia. In the Greek, you see, apostasia simply means departure. That's all it means, folks. Nothing more. Here's the catch. A departure can take place in any number of ways. A departure can take place agreement-wise. When I've changed my mind, I decide to not follow through on something I said, I'm going to back out of the agreement. Is that a departure? Sure it is. One spouse can depart another. Is that a departure? An apostasia. In the agreement department arena, we're going to see that that the Antichrist will depart his own brokered peace treaty during the seven-year period of tribulation later on in our text. But have it firmly established in your minds, a departure can take place in many ways. How about a departure behavior-wise? Can you depart from the way you're conducting yourself? Can a person change his mind and begin to act contrary to the way he once conducted himself or herself? Certainly, a departure can take place. A person can change his thinking. Paul's epistles are full of the doctrine of thinking, the doctrine of adapting for our minds the minds of Christ. Christ's mind being right here. We have the mind of Christ right here. We should renew our thinking so it aligns itself with the mind of Christ. A person can change his thinking. To repent literally means to change one's mind, to change one's thinking. A change of mind can lead to a change of direction. But the word repent simply means a change of mind. The word apostasia, a departure. Now, how about a departure journey-wise? Let's think about it. Can a departure take place in that sense? We do it most every day. You departed your home this morning. Some of you departed many miles away a few days ago so you could be here, so that we might assemble at this at Grace Bible Church. Here's the point. Apostasia simply means departure. Nothing more, nothing less. The context we'd have to use the context to determine what this departure is from. What's taking place here? But again, here's the catch. When looking for a word to describe a defection or a renunciation, a departure from belief or behavior, because that's what they were looking for, English translators chose to take a word from the Greek. And you've probably already guessed which word that would be. What word did they choose? Apostasia, meaning departure and nothing more. They pulled that from the Greek. Thus came the English transliteration, apostasy, from which we have in our Bible, falling away. But is a departure behavior always a departure? Is every departure a departure from behavior? Or belief? Or from home? No. Although the idea of departure is certainly inherent in the English apostasy, you have to know the precise idea of the original writer, the original author, had in mind in order to understand what type of departure is being spoken of. You see some possible problems? If I know that the word apostasy comes from the Greek apostasia, And I already have the English definition of apostasy because we, in our country, have already assigned it a definition. We've taken a word that means apostasy in the Greek, and we've assigned our own definition to it. And then when I come across the Greek word apostasy in Scripture, what am I apt to do? I'm very apt to think that a departure from faith is the issue at hand. Or a departure from conduct is the issue at hand. Because I have in my mind how we use the word apostasy rather than looking at what apostasia meant necessarily in the Greek. It's my opinion that not only did the King James translators do this very thing, because they did, I believe a host of commentators and even some concordances have followed suit. Now stay with me here. What is the context of 1 Thessalonians chapter 2? Paul's comforting these saints. He's providing them hope in view of Israel's upcoming day of the Lord. He's given them a detailed description of their hope. When he comforted them with the truth of the rapture in his first letter, here in his second letter, he's issuing a reminder of the comfort he gave them about their being caught up together to be with the Lord. He reminds of the rapture in verse 1. He reminds that the day of Christ or the day of the Lord is not at hand in verse 2. So the context is what is called our blessed hope. Am I right? Our blessed hope, which is what? The rapture and the great appearing of our great God, the Lord Jesus Christ, in the air to catch us off this planet to be with Him. As Paul told Titus in Titus 2:13, we should all be looking for that blessed hope. The glorious appearing of the great God, Chi, the great God, even our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Not His second coming. We should be looking with earnest expectation toward His secret coming. Secret in the sense that He didn't tell anyone about it. He kept it hidden in His mind until He revealed it to the Apostle Paul for the saints of this present age of grace. So, when you see the expression falling away, read the meaning of the Greek apostasy in its place and see if the context of Paul's comforting words to these saints comes into view. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Verses 1 through 3, now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and by our gathering together unto Him, the rapture, our departure off this earth to be with Christ in the air, that ye be not soon shaken in mind or be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter as from us, as that day of Christ is at hand. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day, what day? The day of the Lord shall not come, the time of Jacob's trouble shall not come, except there come a departure first. Now are you with me? And that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. In fact, for you scholars who may be wondering, the definite article is indeed present. The departure. The departure. For the day of the Lord shall not come except there come the departure, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. If Paul has a specific departure in mind, the context provides very clearly which one he's talking about. The departure of the body of Christ is his sole issue here. That's the only way these saints could be comforted, because they thought they were entering into that time of the tribulation. Then the son of perdition, the man of sin, will come upon the scene. Understand, this is a man we're talking about here. We're not talking about Satan at this point in time, but about the son of perdition, which is one of Satan's principal cohorts, we could say, who will come upon the scene at the beginning of the time of Jacob's trouble. As you well know, Satan is a master counterfeiter. Have we not been talking about that? A master imitator, a master duplicator. What does he want to imitate? Isaiah 14:14. I will ascend upon the heights of the clouds. I will be imitating. I will be duplicating. I will be like the Most High. Satan is a God imitator. Satan is a God imitator. Satan mimics. He copies. He counterfeits God. Is God a triunity? God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, of course He is. Jehovah's Witnesses and Mormons and some others notwithstanding, God is a triunity. We have God the Father, we have God the Son, we have Jesus Christ, who is also God, not a God, but God. Remember, God is a triunity. How about Satan's imitation of the triunity of God? Well, there is Satan. Then there is, as Paul mentions here, there is this son of perdition, which is a direct reference to the Antichrist, the second member of the satanic triad. You see, the Antichrist is not Satan. He's a man who is one of Satan's end-time players. Add in the false prophet to the mix, and you have the satanic triad, the satanic trinity. While they are not the spirit being, Satan himself, they will be energized by the Satan spirit at a point in time during the time of Jacob's trouble. And they will be doing Satan's bidding in a major way. Let me show you all three members of the unholy Trinity in a single verse. Revelation chapter 16, verse 13. And I saw three unclean spirits like frogs come out of the mouth of the dragon. Now that's a reference to Satan, the dragon. And out of the mouth of the beast, there's a reference to the Antichrist. And out of the mouth of the false prophet, there you've got all three. Two of these individuals are human beings, the Antichrist and the false prophet. The other is the devil himself, Satan himself. By the way, the Antichrist is referred to as the beast out of the sea in Revelation chapter 13. The false prophet is called the beast out of the earth in the same chapter. So you can keep the two distinguished. We'll be looking at that in just a moment. Now let's recap some of the things we've talked about concerning the tribulation. The age of grace will come to a close with the rapture of the church, which is the body of Christ. The departure of the saints of this age must take place first, according to Paul, before that tribulation can get underway. Then and only then can the son of perdition, the man of sin, the beast out of the sea, all referring to the same person, the Antichrist, come upon the scene. The Antichrist will be revealed in two stages. His initial manifestation will be when he comes across as the answer man, we've called him here in our studies. The answer man. The diplomat with the solution. A charismatic guru of sorts who people will be drawn to because he will offer the way out of the problems of this earth to the peoples of the earth at that time. This is how the Antichrist will come on the scene at the beginning of the tribulation period. The answer man. He will be able to do what Israel and her enemies have not been able to accomplish throughout the course of their history. And that is establish peace, or at least what will look like the best opportunity toward peace, these warring factions will have seen to that point. He comes on the scene, as we said, with all the answers. And is that not what a whole lot of people are trying to find today? Answers. Just look at the events of just the past few years, folks. Terrorism striking on a huge scale all over the world as we speak. And the common thread that runs through all of these groups is a profound hatred for Israel. Although God is not recognizing Israel, we understand that as a special nation during this present dispensation. They are numbered with the nations. So what is happening now is not included in Israel's wrath time schedule. Nevertheless, there are many factions out there who hate the Jewish people. And according to Scripture, there will come that time after the body of Christ departs this earth when the leaders of the world will be searching for answers. And when there appears to be no solution, the man of sin will come upon the scene and he'll have them. His solution will be his own brokered peace plan. And apparently, if the Arab people who now occupy the Temple Mount still occupy it in that day, they will go along with this peace plan. All will seem to go well. We learn from the prophetic scriptures for the first 3.5 years of that tribulation period. But you see, it's still a time of wrath. Some have said, how could it be a time of wrath if all goes well? Is God allowing Satan to exercise his plan? It's a time of wrath for Israel, folks. But at the midpoint of the time of Jacob's trouble, right at the midpoint, how many years do we have in the tribulation? What's the midpoint? 3.5. This man of sin will reveal himself in an entirely different manner. Up to this point, he's been what? The answer man. The man with a plan. But halfway through the tribulation, he's going to reveal himself in an entirely different fashion. This is why the final 3.5 years of the tribulation are called the Great Tribulation. This is precisely what Christ was referring to in Matthew 24, when he said, "For then shall be great tribulation," 3.5 years in, "such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, no, nor ever shall be." The Antichrist will enter the temple. He will demand the worship of men. He will show himself to be God. You can see the counterfeit, I'm sure, here. Can you not? Christ is going to rule and reign and set up his throne here on earth. But the Antichrist is going to claim that that time has come. And he is the one who Israel has been awaiting. He is her husband. He's come to return for his bride. After all, his peace treaty included the proviso that Israel could once again offer their sacrifices in temple worship. And they will have been doing that for the first 3.5 years. Now, I want to show you a companion verse sitting in the book of Revelation, which pictures this time of Antichrist's second revealing. The second first revealing is when? The answer man, the man with the plan, entrance of the tribulation. But then his second revealing is 3.5 years into the tribulation. He's revealed in an entirely different manner. Revelation chapter 13, notice with me verse 1. And I stood upon the sand of the sea. John has been shown some things which are to come here. And John states here, I saw a beast rise up out of the sea. Remember, this first beast, the beast out of the sea, is a reference to who? The Antichrist. Having seven heads, 10 horns, and upon his horns, 10 crowns, and upon his heads, the name of blasphemy. Now, we don't have time to go into all the symbolism that's sitting here in this passage, but suffice it to say that Daniel predicted that the Roman Empire would be revived in a 10-kingdom form. I think we know that. Daniel 7:24. The seven heads indicate seven different ruling authorities. Move on to verse 2 with me. Did I do it? Thank you. And the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard, and his feet were as the feet of a bear, and his mouth as the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave him his power and his seat and great authority. Who's the dragon? Satan. The dragon or Satan is energizing this individual, this man of sin, who's like unto a leopard, John wrote. His feet were as the feet of a bear, and his mouth as the mouth of a lion. If you think back to Daniel chapter 7, where Daniel describes the nations that would serve themselves of Israel, the leopard symbolized the Grecian Empire. The bear was a type of Medo-Persia. And the lion represented Babylon. What we have here then is the idea that this revived Roman Empire will resemble its predecessors in that it will be swift to conquer, like a leopard, powerful as a bear, and greedy as a lion. In short, we could say that this revived end-time empire will combine all the evil features of the preceding world empires back in Daniel's day. And this end-time empire will receive supernatural strength from Satan himself, from the dragon. You think Satan will have given up his role as evil imitator when that day comes? Not about to. Watch verse 3. And I saw one of his heads, as it were, wounded to death. And his deadly wound was what? Healed. And all the world wondered after the beast. An excitedly awestruck world at the miraculous power of this beast from the sea. The Antichrist in his second stage, Revelation. Talk about a miracle worker deluxe. Benny Hinn would have to take a second seat. Here we see this individual take a deadly wound. The Bible says that, as it were, wounded to death, John says, and yet he comes back to life at this midpoint of the tribulation period. Now, I don't have to tell you the event and the person this miraculous coming back to life is counterfeiting. Who died rose from the dead. Of course, Jesus Christ. Satan is simply imitating here the resurrection of our Savior with an apparent Antichrist resurrection. And little wonder the world will be awestruck. Watch a TV presentation of any of our present-day so-called faith healers and see if you don't witness Colosseums full of excitedly awestruck onlookers to the fakery that's being offered up in our time. Certain denominations today are preparing the soil, are they not? But the miracles on this end-time counterfeiter will leave nothing to the imagination. It won't be a leg supposedly growing a little longer now or an unseeable cure from a purported illness. This will be a very witnessable resurrection from the dead. If people believe the fall are all being foisted on folks today, you can only imagine how quickly they will respond to this satanic miracle in that day to come. I can almost hear them say, "Why, that has to be God." Can you hear it? How many times have I heard that expression in my pre-rite division days as I was caught up in the money-making, healing hoopla of our modern ministers? Revelation 13, point 4. And they worshipped the dragon, which gave power unto the beast. Oh. And they worshipped the beast, saying, "Who is like unto the beast, this Antichrist? Who's able to make war with this fellow?" And there was given unto him a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies, and power was given unto him to continue 42 months. Where are our mathematicians here? Have we got some mathematicians? 42 months are equivalent to how many years? 42 divided by 12, 3.5 years. What did Paul just say in 2 Thessalonians? "Who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God." You see the correspondence in 2 Thessalonians 2.4 and Revelation 13.4.5? They are both referring to the very same thing, which I believe will help us in our interpretation of the so-called restrainer in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 7. Let's go there. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 7. And now ye know what withholdeth, that he might be revealed in his time. For the mystery of iniquity doth already work, only he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. Something was withholding or letting, but what does it mean to withhold and to let? Well, that's a not common language for today, is it? Not necessarily. The common word, or the word that is most often used today for both of these terms, is the word restrain. So the common thought is something, someone is restraining sin until the man of sin is revealed. Is that not the common thought? Is that not what crossed your mind? The traditional interpretation would say, whatever or whoever it is that's restraining sin today must be taken out of the way in order for the Antichrist to come upon the scene. Somebody's holding sin back. But when that sin stops being held back, boy, you're going to get the Antichrist. The question then is, what is it and who is it that's restraining sin? Let me share with you some of the views that have been adopted throughout history. For centuries, the most popular view among ancient scholars was that the Roman Empire, more particularly the Roman Emperor, was the restraining force preventing the revelation of the man of lawlessness. After all, the thought line went, the Roman Empire had a system of law and order, many of the things of which have carried over into our present-day system, folks. So in a sense, the Roman Empire was a restrainer of sinfulness at that time. But would that make the Roman Empire the restrainer of the man of lawlessness? One commentator wrote, it's easier to believe that Nero was the man of lawlessness than to believe that he was the one holding back his appearance. Then around the Middle Ages, another view came to the forefront. As early as the 11th century, there was an attempt to associate the establishment and development of popedom with the Antichrist. And by the time of the Reformation, this view was becoming quite widespread and popular. By the way, both Luther and Calvin are said to have supported this view. The problem with this view is, how could the believers at Thessalonica have possibly understood such an interpretation? Remember, Paul said, and now ye know what withholdeth that man of sin that might be revealed in his time. Difficult to believe the Apostle Paul told the saints in Thessalonica about an upcoming Catholic Church. So it wasn't the Catholic Church, was it? Or about the Pope, for that matter. Hard to believe that Paul would explain to these saints in Thessalonica that there was going to be a Pope coming, and this Pope was going to restrain sin. And Paul said to these Thessalonican saints, you already know what's holding him back. So it wasn't the Catholic Church or the Pope. This view is still popular in some circles today, folks, although it's not the most popular view. Then there's the view that is favored in some Roman Catholic circles. Some of these folks interpret the restrainer to be Michael the Archangel. How about that one? In other words, Michael has to be taken out of the way, or at least held back, in order for the Antichrist to make his appearance. Really? Here's a far-fetched view. A fellow by the name of B.B. Warfield came up with this one. He suggested that the restraining force could be the Jewish state. There's no end to these views, is there? Go figure that one. The Jewish state must be taken out of the way in order for the Antichrist to come along and make a treaty with the Jewish state. Kind of doesn't make sense, does it? Well, lay all those ideas aside, and let me give you the most popular view. We'll call this one the contemporary view. It came along in the early part of the 19th century. According to the contemporary view, the view of most of Christendom so-called today, the restrainer of 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, the one who is holding back the appearance of the Antichrist, is none other than the third member of the Godhead, God the Holy Spirit. Have you heard it? Here's the reasoning. Every Bible student worth his Schofield knows that the Holy Spirit resides where? In this present dispensation, where does he reside? In the believer, in the believers who comprise the body of Christ. Listen to Paul, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19. I don't think it's on there. What, know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is where? In you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own. The reasoning continues, since the Holy Spirit takes up residence within the believers of this age, and since the Holy Spirit is the one who's doing the restraining, then when the church of this age is caught up off this planet at the time of the rapture, where would the Holy Spirit be? Why, he's gone with the church. So goes the reasoning. But do you catch a small problem with this viewpoint? One problem, and a major one from my vantage point, is that this view puts a finite value on the Holy Spirit. In other words, when Paul got saved, Paul being the first member of the church of this age, the Holy Spirit entered Paul. Got it? Then when the next person got saved, the Holy Spirit entered that individual, and so on it went, until the rapture takes place, and there's no more left of the Holy Spirit. He's in all the believers, but there's no more left to be put anywhere else. You see the reasoning? Lo and behold, after nearly 2,000 years of this age of grace, as it's marched along, there just is as much of the Holy Spirit left to go around. When the last member of the body of Christ is saved, why, he'll be all used up. So when the church is gone, where's all of the Holy Spirit? Seems absurd, doesn't it? But that's the logic if you follow the Holy Spirit restrainer idea through faithfully. Here's the catch. When you study Scripture, you'll find that the Holy Spirit was here prior to the church of this age. The Holy Spirit's not a thing of gallonage or tonnage that's going to run out. The Holy Spirit never runs out. The Holy Spirit is Spirit. When this age of grace comes to a close, there will be folks who will never have heard Paul's gospel who will come to believe the message of the 144,000 Jewish ministers proclaiming the good news of the kingdom. Folks who come to believe the Scriptures specially prepared for them in that day, which rightly dividers recognize to be Hebrews through Revelation. These are tribulation epistles. It's the Holy Spirit who works through the Word of God in our age. Do you not believe that the Holy Spirit will not be working through the through His Word in the age to come? Do you not suppose the Holy Spirit will be the comforter to the kingdom saints during the tribulation period? We're not running out of Holy Spirit, are we? Sure He will, and He doesn't have to indwell in order to do that. In fact, according to Israel's prophet Joel, the Holy Spirit will be poured out at that time like never before. He'll not be taken away. He'll be poured out when that time comes. Folks, there will be no absence of the Holy Spirit on this planet, whether we're here or not. So it isn't the Holy Spirit who's gone with the church that's restraining sin, that's restraining the man of sin, keeping him from coming. So I don't see the Holy Spirit as being the restrainer of the Antichrist here. How about this view? View taken by many who rightly divide the word of truth. They would see the restraining force as either Paul's gospel or the dispensation of the grace of God itself as the restraining force. In other words, it's the reality of this present unprophesied age. It's God's plan associated with this age that must come to completion prior to the manifesting of the Antichrist. We do know that God will not reinstitute His program with Israel, the earthly kingdom program, until the fullness of the Gentiles be brought in or until this present age comes to a close. So the idea here is that the restraining force must be this present age of grace, which must be brought to a close before the Antichrist can come up on the scene. Now, rightly dividers don't have a problem here, do they? That fits pretty well in our way of reasoning things. The restraining force would be this age of grace, and the one would have to be taken out of the way would be the age. Would obviously be the one new man, the body of Christ. A rightly divider could buy into that pretty quickly, couldn't he? That seems to serve our cause when it comes to right division. Sure sounds good. And it very well might be the case, but let me throw another idea into the kettle here. There's something interesting here. Look at the passage with me one more time, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. And now ye know what withholdeth, that he might be revealed in his time, for the mystery of iniquity doth already work, only he who now letteth will let, and till he be taken out of the way, and then shall that wicked be revealed. In verse 6, something was withholding, isn't it? Verse 7, someone who is letting. Now, I certainly don't intend to be dogmatic about this approach. I just want to show it to you because who really knows for certain exactly what Paul had in mind, but I want to take a closer look at the words withholdeth in verse 6 and letteth in verse 7. Because a proper understanding of these two words are really key to understanding the passage. By the way, both are translated from the very same Greek root here, kateko. Kateko. I know it's been translated withhold in verse 6 and letteth in verse 7. And I also know that most commentators substitute the word restrain in the sense of holding something back. In this case, we think of that which is being held back as being the Antichrist. He's being held back from coming upon the scene. Is that not the idea we get? But does kateko always have to do with holding something back? Stay with me. Let's look at the same word as it's used elsewhere in the Bible. Tell me if you see in this passage holding back. Prove all things, kateko. Is that hold back? Hold fast that which is good. Tell me, is holding fast the same thing as holding back or restraining? It's the same Greek word, folks. Let's look further because kateko is used again in 2 Corinthians 6:10. As sorrowful, yet always rejoicing. As poor, yet making many rich. As having nothing, and yet holding back all things. Possessing all things. It doesn't look like holding back to me, but holding on to me. Does it look more like holding back or like holding on? Which one? Holding on. Hold fast in this passage. Possessing in another passage, both talking about holding on to something. Let's look at another. This comes from Philemon 13. Let's mesh up there. Turn to Hezekiah. Whom I would have kateko, or retained with me, that in thy stead he might have ministered unto me in the bonds of the gospel. What do you do when you retain something? You hold on to it, don't you? You see in verse 6, something is holding on to someone. Ye know what withholdeth. But in verse 7, someone is holding on to something. Sounds confusing, doesn't it? I know it does, but stay here with me a minute. In Matthew 21, verse 28, kateko is translated seize. Again, the idea is not so much holding back, but holding on. Keep the idea in mind. One more. See if the idea is not the same here in Luke 4:42, speaking of Christ. And when it was day, he, Christ, departed and went into a desert place, and the people sought him out. They came unto him, and here's our word kateko. They did what? They stayed him. Whoops, did I do? They stayed him, that he should not depart from them. They stayed him by holding on to him. Hold fast, seize, possess, all used for kateko. They didn't restrain him from coming into their midst. They held on to him from having him leave their midst. Now let's go back to 2 Thessalonians 2, 6, 8. And now ye know what possesses. Now ye know what's holding on, what's holding fast, that he, the Antichrist, might be revealed in his time. I believe this is talking about the midpoint of the tribulation right here. The second revealing of the Antichrist. And something is holding someone fast. Keep the idea in mind here. For the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Only he who now is holding on will continue to hold on until that one who is holding on will be taken out of the way. Are you with me? And then shall that wicked be revealed. He's not revealed. Not yet. He can't be revealed until the one that's holding on, holding fast, holding on is taken out of the way. What is holding on to something in verse 6? And who is holding on to something in verse 7? The answer just might be lying in the book of Revelation. Because there we find the same events unfolded prophetically. In the middle of the tribulation period, the unholy Trinity will come together. They'll come together to carry out Satan's program. And the first beast, being the Antichrist, will be manifested for who he really is. Follow with me here now. Remember, the Antichrist will have already enjoyed his career as the answer man, the man with the plan, for 3.5 years. Now, nice guy, treaty broker, diplomat mask is about to come off. Watch. And the woman, Revelation 12:6, representing Israel, fled into the wilderness where she hath a place prepared of God, that they should feed her there for 1,200 threescore years, or 3 score days, 3.5 years. Midpoint of the tribulation, this is taking place. Right in the middle of the tribulation. This is when Israel is told to flee into the wilderness. Mid-tribulation, keep reading. And there was a war in heaven. When? At this 3.5 year point of the tribulation, there's a war in heaven. Mid-tribulation, a war, a major battle taking place in the heavenlies. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon. Who's the dragon? Satan. And the dragon fought against his angels. How will this battle turn out? Verse 8. And the dragon, Satan, and his angelic host prevailed not, neither was their place found any more in heaven. If they're cast out of heaven, and they have to go through a battle in order to prevail not, what's the prevailing about? Not being cast out of heaven. Is that correct? And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Satan and his angels cast out of the heavenly realm, which is their current dwelling place. Not the third heaven, where God's throne room resides, but the second realm of the heavenlies. Satan will be cast out, meaning thrown down, tossed out. Does that sound to you like he will be wanting to go? Would there have to be a battle take place if he wanted to go, to be cast down to the earth? Or does that sound to you like he's forced to leave? Sounds like forced to me. Where is their place or seat of authority at the present time, folks? The second realm of the heavenlies from which they currently conduct the plan of evil. Satan instigated back in the garden. The place from which they will be cast out when this 3.5 year tribulation period comes to pass. But Satan's not going to want to go, or there would need to be a battle between Michael and his angels and Satan and his. There would be no need for this great heavenly conflict between Michael and his forces and Satan and his. Satan cast out of the heavenlies, confined to planet Earth to carry out the remainder of his evil imitating, which is precisely what he will do. Remember the verse we just looked at that time? And I saw one of his heads as it were wounded to death, and his deadly wound was healed, and all the world wondered after the beast, and they worshipped the beast. They worshipped the dragon, Satan, which gave power unto the beast. And they worshipped the beast, saying, who is like unto this beast? Who is able to make war with him? And there was given unto him, the Antichrist, a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies, and power was given unto him to continue 42 months, the final 3.5 years. You not find it interesting that when Satan is forced out of the heavenly realm, the realm to which he will have been holding on with all he has, he doesn't want to be cast out. It's at this very point, the point of his being taken out of the way, that his miraculous powers are then manifested to the people upon the earth in an open way in the realm of healing, right here in the midst of the people. Put it together, folks. He's currently holding on to his position, his place, in the realm of the heavenlies to which he's been given access, the second realm. At the midpoint of the tribulation, though, Michael musters God's angelic armies and Satan is forcibly thrown out. Only he who now is holding on will continue to hold on until he be taken out of the way. At which time, as we've just seen, he will miraculously, satanic miracle, heal the Antichrist. Interesting thing, Paul told these saints in Thessalonica, for the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Are you with me so far? What's Paul saying here? He's saying that Satan will do, at the midpoint of the tribulation period, performing the miraculous healing power he is doing right now behind the scenes. It will be manifested then. Satan is counterfeiting the hand of God. And what better time for him to do so than during the age of grace, when God has so clearly told us through Paul that he is not allowing us to walk by sight but by faith. Satan is counterfeiting God in the miracle department, in our assemblies across the country, and even within our grace assemblies to some degree. And people are buying into it in ever-increasing droves. And when you say Satan is behind the miraculous, Satan does all these things that you're praying and asking God to do, we're accused of putting him in a box or not believing in prayer. Little wonder Satan is the one holding on to his heavenly place. Because we don't know who's doing it right now, and who are we crediting? Isn't God good? He works his wonders at the time of his choosing within earth's religious structures. And scripturally ignorant masses are giving God the credit today, saying, isn't God good? Because the things that are happening that are good are happening with the context of our prayer life and happening with the context of our assemblies. Who are we calling God when we say, isn't God good, if Satan is behind the miraculous? What was Satan's desire? To be as God. What does Satan want? To be glorified as God. He's going to sit in the temple and claim he is God. Satan will indeed have to be taken out of the way or forcibly removed from his heavenly position before the Antichrist can be manifested to believing Israel for who he really is, Satan's sinister sidekick, with Satan as the true empowerer. Do you now see what the mystery of iniquity is, folks? Satan will be overtly manifesting himself as the power behind the miraculous during the tribulation period. Right now, he's covertly manifesting himself as the power source behind the miracles that are being performed today. In many, I think, answers to prayer that are happening in our age. This is why it's called the mystery or the secret of iniquity. Beginning to make some more sense to you? Satan must be cast out of the heavenly realm in order for the mystery of iniquity to become a mystery no longer. Satan has to be cast out of the heavenly realm before men on the earth will see that it's Satan that's doing the miraculous, not God at all. You see why it's so critically important when God said, my grace is sufficient for you, Paul. For my strength is made perfect in your weakness. And what are we saying? Good enough for Paul, not good enough for us. Well, we just gather our prayer power together and we get God to change the outcome of our circumstances today. Is God working today? You bet. I believe he is. But I don't believe he's giving you a way to see that it's him working. We didn't have time to cover it in detail, but the false prophet will complete the unholy trinity. He will enter on the scene at the same time, mid-tribulation. Where will the false prophet come from? And I beheld another beast coming up out of the sea. If you want to see this in more detail, you might look at Revelation chapter 9, verses 1 through 3 sometime. And he, this beast who will come up from out of the earth, the bottomless pit, possibly Tartarus, could the bottomless pit be restraining the evil spirit at that time, who had two horns like a lamb, and he spake as a dragon? He exerciseth all power of the first beast before him, and causeth the earth and them which dwell therein to worship the first beast, the Antichrist, whose deadly wound was healed. And he, the false prophet, doeth great wonders, so that he maketh fire come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men, and deceiveth them that dwell on the earth by means of those miracles which he had power to do. Now read that. And deceiveth them that dwell on the earth by means of those miracles which he had power to do. What was the second word? And deceiveth. What did Paul say would be taking place in connection with ministers of righteousness our day? Being deceived and deceiving people. But the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Satan is deceiving people today in a religious structure as we pray for things to happen in our life and say, isn't God good, when the earthly things we've got our view in come to pass as we would expect them to or want them to. And Satan is robbing God of his glory as we sit here this evening, as we say in our testimony time, look what God did for me this week. What will he do for you next? And we say, isn't God good? And Satan is basking in the glory that he's behind the counterfeit, imitating, duplicating, carbon copy miracles we would expect only God to perform. Should we stand with Paul and say, forget what I see around me, good or bad? God's grace is sufficient for me. Where are we leading people down the path of isn't God goodism of today? God is good no matter the circumstance. God is good if things are wonderful in your life. God is good if things are turned upside down in your life. God is good. If we look at the things of this earth and our prayer life is focused on the things of this earth, I'm convinced in my mind that a glory-seeking, glory-stealing, glory-robbing Satan would be glad to give you what you want, so that you will say, isn't God good, because he is taking the credit as God and will when he sits in that temple. This is heavy on my mind as I see what's happening in our day, and so sadly to me that it's happening within our grace assemblies in our day. God's grace is sufficient for us. His word tells us everything we need to know to conduct ourselves so that we might put our faith on display in the midst of our troubling circumstances. Let's turn our focus off of earthly things, whether they be health, wealth, prosperity in any sense, and let's begin to look heavenly. And thank God that he's going to return for us before this particular thing takes place. But Paul wants us to know the mystery of iniquity is working right now in and out of the churches of across our country, and unfortunately right within our grace assemblies in many instances, as people reject the truth when it's presented to them and tell you, oh, you're putting God in a box. I'm going to take him out of your box. Let's keep the age of grace in the box. Let's keep Pauline truth in the box where it belongs, and not open the box and allow God's program with Israel in. That's what rightly dividing the word of truth is all about. I hope you've enjoyed our time. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for who you are. Thank you that you've left us with your word, that you remove the doubt. Your word clears up these things so that we can see that not only we, but you yourself are fighting a sinister evil, an evil scheme, an evil person, an evil spirit, the enemy. Help us to be aware of what's taking place around us, to not let superstition overcome us, to not let the supernatural overcome us, to not drag it into the age of grace, but to come to believe what Paul believed, that you told him, my grace is sufficient for you. Your grace is certainly sufficient for me. And I pray that we would all adopt that mindset, stop looking at the earthly realm and begin to focus our realm, our eyes heavenward to that blessed event called the blessed hope when you return in the air and catch us off this planet and the departure of the body of Christ takes place. You call your ambassadors home. What a glorious day that will be. We would love to have it appear in our day, but we know only you know. We give you all the glory. What a wonderful salvation we have. You did all the doing through your Son. We do only all the receiving. And you save us to the uttermost. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.